presenting a world of home entertainment for your enjoyment from Thorn EMI Video. Movie blockbusters, action classics, children's films, top TV shows, and much, much more. So, for now, sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Number one, the first locomotive of the Sydney Railway Company. It survived not only a normal working life, but more than a century of disuse, to be rescued, beautifully restored, and now to spend the rest of its time here as a silent museum piece. But it's somehow wrong to me to see one of these machines so dead, so silent. Because they were never silent. They always had something to say for themselves. And to us, their admirers, these, of all of man's machines, these were the only ones that had life. Even at rest, they breathed and pulsed. Now, number one is not going to breathe again. But around Australia, there are groups of people determined to preserve the sight and sound of steam in Australia.
These films from the archives of the ABC television programs, Weekend Magazine and The Big Country are about the achievements and the plans of those dedicated enthusiasts who are keeping the steam trains running.
Whistling up the past, steam engine 933 climbs through the Flinders Ranges in South Australia on a trip from Quorne. Once the small town of Quorne was an important railway centre, but these days the imposing railway station, opened in 1916, springs to life only at weekends and in school holidays. It's then that tourists and steam train enthusiasts stream in, attracted by old engines and the pitchy Ritchie railway line. The visitors have been coming to Quorne since 1974 for a nostalgia trip by courtesy of the Pitchy Ritchie Railway Preservation Society. The society has achieved one of the most outstanding examples of railway line restoration in Australia. Members, working in their spare time, have restored 16 kilometres of track from Quorne and through the Pitchy Ritchie Pass towards Port Augusta. The restoration is a memorial to great days long gone. Once, the narrow gauge line was part of both the East-West Transcontinental Link and the line to Alice Springs. A regular worker on the line is Roger Perling, who drives diesel locos for a living and drives steam for love.
There's something about a steam locomotive that talks to you. It's a living thing. A diesel is just a big truck engine and just open the throttle and away you go. But this steam locomotive gives its work in relation to what the driver and the fireman can put into it. If they work as a good crew and a good team, the locomotive should perform well.
It seems to me that it's a heck of a lot of hard work. Is that right?
It is, but that's the fun of it, because we're not being paid. It's purely a hobby.
On this occasion, the train was making the first passenger run on an extension to the line recently restored by the amateur track layers of the Preservation Society. an extension from Pitchy Ritchie to Woolshed Flat. With an appropriate regard for history, the trip marked the 100th anniversary of the first passenger train on the line. After many decades of usefulness, the old line began languishing in the 1950s when a change of route and gauge took Central Australian traffic away from it. The line officially closed in 1972, but within 2 years, the Pitchy Ritchie Railway Preservation Gangers had a section restored, and soot, steam and cinders were once again providing the gritty glamour of old-style locomotion for thousands of cash customers. It's a slow uphill haul from Quorn to Woolshed Flat. The grade is 1 in 60, and the round trip takes about 2 hours. However, the run to Woolshed Flat is really a trip to nowhere but a place name, so no one is in a hurry. Although scores of volunteers do restoration work for the Pitchy Ritchie Railway, the Society acknowledges valuable help from outside resources. Their workshops, on the site of Quorn's once huge and busy locomotive depot, were built with help from the old Rural Employment Development Scheme. Here, old locomotives and carriages are overhauled and restored. It costs tens of thousands of dollars to get an engine into first-class running order and paint it up to look like new. It's taken much more than money, though, to make the Pitchy Ritchie railway line such a popular tourist attraction. According to country storekeeper, postmaster and steam buff Jack Babbage, the work also required a lot of sweat and muscle.
10,000 sleepers have been put into the track since we started. I think the figure in the amount of dog spikes which hold the sleepers onto the rails, or the rails onto the sleepers, something of the order of over 100 tonnes of those alone. And of course, they all have to be put in by hand. And quite apart from the track work, you've also got the carriage restoration. There's a tremendous amount of work goes into restoring these carriages as they come to some fairly decrepit condition. And the locos themselves take a tremendous amount of work, of course.
The Society has 600 members, many of them from interstate and even overseas. Naturally, they're people from a wide range of occupations. Some are working railway men who instruct the others. Each year, the members subscribe $10,000 in fees, and the Society also receives a flow of private donations. On holiday weekends, when a train is running, the population of Quorn, normally 1,000, just about doubles with the influx of tourists Pitchy Ritchie bound. The line, small though it is, means much to Quorn. The town has long depended on trains, and there were many who thought it would become a ghost town when the line closed in 1972. Half the population moved out, but tourism, generated largely by the line, and farming is keeping what's left of Quorn in business. End of the line, Woolshed Flat. But already plans are underway to press on with track restoration. Beyond Woolshed Flat are another 17 kilometres, waiting for the restorer's dog spikes. This work would open the line to Stirling North, outside Port Augusta. One 100 years ago, people from Quorn and Port Augusta took the first passenger train to Woolshed Flat for a cricket match in the wilderness. Members of the Pitchy Ritchie Railway Preservation Society hope that one day they too will be able to run trains from Port Augusta as well as from Quorn. The achievement, no doubt, will be marked by quite a cricket match.
Queenstown, on Tasmania's west coast, has had its problems recently. 7 years ago, a dip in world copper prices almost sent the whole town to the wall. The federal government and the Tasmanian government came to the aid of Queenstown then with a financial subsidy to keep afloat the town's major employer, Mount Lyell Mines. However, more recent federal intervention, in the form of the decision to stop the Gordon Below Franklin Dam project, has not been so welcome. This month, though, Queenstown has been setting aside its problems to celebrate its centenary. For the occasion, the town made careful plans. Among them was a memorial to the pioneers who carved a life out of the thick rainforest last century. Queenstown's tribute, perhaps surprisingly in a very practical environment, is a work of art, and at the same time a means of rescuing for posterity one of the essential ingredients in its very survival. Bill Lane reports.
20 years ago, the Apt Railway was the lifeline of Tasmania's west coast. The mineral-rich mountainous west depended on the sturdy trains to rail out its concentrates and earn its livelihood. Before massive trucks and heavy machinery, rail was the only way Queenstown's copper could be moved to its link with the outside world at Strawn. The ruggedness of the area posed special problems of its own, and the answer was the Apt Railway system. When it closed in the early 1960s, a special television program was produced to mark its passing.
The rugged little loco develops 210 horsepower. Once out of the valley plain, the going is tough. Too tough for just one engine. The unique feature of the line is a central track between the rails that provides extra traction for the steep grades. This, with the help of a second loco, gets the train across country otherwise impenetrable by rail. Climb up is almost over. The train approaches Reinerdina. There's a stop here for water and oil.
Times change. Although the Apt train has not survived as a means of transport, it could still be a means of bringing people to the west coast following the tourist trail. The people of Queenstown embarked on a project at the start of this year to rebuild a remnant of the Apt railway. The hat was passed around the state government, the Mount Lyell Mining Company and the Queenstown Council to raise $120,000 for a rescue operation to save just one old loco. It was in an almost hopeless state of ruin, and bringing it back to its gleaming glory has taken hundreds of hours of painstaking work. Part of the money raised for the project went to commissioning one of Australia's best-known sculptors, Stephen Walker, to design a monument marking the town's centenary and the railway's involvement in its development.
Well, for many years, the railway line connection between Queenstown and Strawn was really the only connection to the outside world. The Apt part, which makes made the railway unique, was the fact that it went up and over some very steep hills, and so it was this particular characteristic that always seemed to generate the fact that the train huffed and puffed and generated a lot of steam, and it wasn't fast, and it always seemed to generate a lot of love amongst the people who used it. And even the sort of nostalgia that we see at the present time is apparent in that love.
The design for the monument incorporates a trestle bridge of Tasmanian hewn pine over a stream of running water. It's aimed at representing the spectacular King River crossing as the track makes its way to Strawn. The original bridge over the King has gone. In just 20 years, floods and fire have swept it away, and there's now little to see of it or of the railway line itself. The rainforest is creeping back, and it may not be long before retracing the track will be a bushman's job. But there's hope that Stephen Walker's work will keep the railway alive and well, if only in memory.
20 years ago, when this line was closed, if somebody had said we're going to do this in 20 years' time to represent the locomotive, it would have been seen as nonsense. But I think in 20 years from now, we could well see an even more major rearrangement. I don't say that the Apt railway line itself will ever reopen in one big section, but I can certainly see a recreation of the atmosphere of the Apt railway with one of the genuine engines operating on that section.
The train has come 21 miles and has taken 2 hours, but its time is running out. Motor trucks will replace it to carry the ores from Queenstown to Strawn.
Engine 3526 was leaving Central Station in Sydney on a sentimental journey. Mr. and Mrs. Bob Collins were among 350 people making a nostalgic trip to the mountains organised by the Australian Railway Historical Society. The Collins made just such a journey for their honeymoon in 1922. In the great days of steam, 3526 hauled the famous Honeymoon Express to Katoomba in the Blue Mountains west of Sydney. Travelling with the Collins were some 30 other couples who also had gone by steam train to the Blue Mountains for their honeymoon in the 1920s and 30s. It was during this period that the Caves Express got its more popular name, the Honeymoon Express. Younger steam enthusiasts shared the nostalgia with the former honeymooners. Everyone enthused about the good old days, when life seemed much simpler and happier. The Collins brought along their wedding photographs, taken shortly before they joined the ranks of tens of thousands of couples who've honeymooned in the mountains during the past century. Mr. Collins was 24 then, Mrs. Collins, 23. Throughout every honeymoon trip, the engine sounded its whistle to announce that newlyweds were on board. For a time in the 30s, the Honeymoon Express also ran under the name of the Blue Train, an attempt to identify it with the blue haze of the mountains. The engine was then, and still is, painted blue. This trip to Katoomba took about half an hour longer than the 2 hours and 4 minutes it took the inaugural express to make the journey. 3526 is kept in perfect running order by the Department of Railways and organizations of steam enthusiasts. The Caves Express went off the run in 1942 because of the war. So hundreds of Katoomba residents turned out to share nostalgic memories with passengers on the old steam train. A 38-class locomotive pulling the Flyer up the Cowan bank of the Hawkesbury River, New South Wales, in 1958. The sight and sound of 3808 in action are prized possessions of Mrs. Doris Jones, a member of the New South Wales Rail Transport Museum. Her bedroom is a steam museum in itself, and the tape recording that provides her background music is one of several hundred she's made of steam trains all over Australia. The steam gauge is another souvenir of a great 38-class locomotive, long since turned into scrap. There's nothing quite like the enthusiasm of steam buffs. In this bedroom, there are a few conventional feminine touches. They've had to give way to gauges, brass brake handles, valves, and connecting rods from steam engines sent for scrapping as diesels and electric trains took over. Some of the parts were quite expensive and heavy. The brass safety valve on the bedroom floor weighs 70 pounds and costs $40.
But there's more to being a steam enthusiast than just collecting. It's possible to work on the real thing. Every weekend, volunteer members of the Rail Transport Museum work on restoring old steam engines handed over by the New South Wales Railways Department. This is 3203, the latest restored by the dedicated members. It joins a collection of more than 30 steam engines and assorted items of rolling stock at the Enfield Locomotive Sheds in Sydney. The steam buffs have been working for 10 years preparing the museum for public exhibition. It was officially opened today. The oldest engine on display was built at the Redfern workshops 95 years ago. Doris Jones was asked about her interest in steam by Jim Rabbit.
Doris, what fascinates you about steam trains?
Well, I think it's the wonderful sound they make, the motion of the wheels going round and the display of steam and smoke, because after all, they are a living machine.
How long have you been interested in it?
Since I was a little girl of about six. Somehow they appealed to me. I used to listen to them when I lay in bed of a night. I lived on the Blue Mountains, and then coming home from school, I was close to the line, and I used to wait, and when I saw the signal down, I knew there was one coming, so I used to wait and watch it. And ever since then, they've fascinated me.
It's one thing liking steam trains and to watch them pass by. It's another thing to spend your weekends polishing and painting them. Why do you do it?
Because I think I've got a really deep devotion towards the steam locomotive.
3820 is one of the museum's finest engines. It's venerated by steam enthusiasts as the locomotive that thrilled a generation of children as it roared along with express trains. In 1970, it was the first steam train to travel from the east to the west coast of Australia. The trip attracted steam devotees from all states, America, Britain, and New Zealand. 3820 was built in 1946 and weighs almost 200 tons. The shunting engine was built in America 50 years ago for use at the BHP Steelworks in Newcastle. The 35 class was introduced in 1914 for heavy express, mail and passenger services. It was well known along the New South Wales coast. To get an old engine into top condition requires people like Jill McNiven to devote years of spare time to scraping, painting and polishing. Museum members are divided into project gangs and work together on an engine, not only during restoration, but also for maintenance. The devotees of steam include many railwaymen who find diesel locomotives a bore, and their museum work is a labour of love. David Fields is a railway signalman. The work also includes providing facilities for visitors, such as barbecue shelters made from engine cabins that once resounded to steam power. A great day for the museum. 3203, newly restored, is ready for its inaugural trip with a full load of passengers. The children stand in awe, as children have for more than 150 years. It's never difficult to fill the seats for a trip behind a steam engine. Most journeys are day trips, but there are longer excursions, such as one recently to Whyalla in South Australia for the opening of the new standard gauge railway from Port Augusta. The more enthusiastic passengers note every detail, and their stopwatches check for the slightest variation to schedule. The vintage trains are taken into the country as often as possible, so that country people too can have a chance to share in the magic of steam. There's a strong family atmosphere about such trips. A simple pleasure, easily shared. A relaxed journey, rich with nostalgia for the adults and fascinating discovery for the children. Enthusiasts say that all the senses are stimulated by a steam haul train. There's an endless variety of sights, sounds, and smells. In engine 3203 was built in 1892 for a little more than £7,000. It was handed over to the museum in 1967 and is expected to remain in operation for many more years. More than 150 engines of the 32 class were in service by 1911, and for 70 years they pulled most of the passenger trains in New South Wales.
Well, I'm just thinking how wonderful it is to be behind it, to be able to listen to it. What a wonderful thing it is, the sound and everything. Somehow I listen to it all the way, on the trip, there and back. I always like to get up near the engine so I can listen to the beat.
Scores of motorists usually follow every steam train excursion from Sydney, photographing it and recording the sound. There are also scheduled photographic stops along the way so that the passengers can get off for pictures. On this trip, the bridge at Menangle provided an ideal location for the cameras. Steam engines have inspired many poets, including Britain's Stephen Spender, who wrote these words. It is now she begins to sing, at first quite low, then loud, and at last with a jazzy madness, the song of her whistle screaming at the curves, of deafening tunnels, breaks, innumerable bolts. Then it was all aboard for the run back to Sydney. For the passengers, it was a day to remember. A day when steam was king.
The Australian sugar industry has always been a dynamic one, always ready to improve itself. But its origins were tough and even tragic. In the 1860s, Pacific Islanders, the Kanakas, were employed as forced labour on the Queensland cane fields. Today, the Kanakas are gone. So too are the incredibly hard-working gangs of hand cutters who followed them. Now, progress has also caught up with the little steam locomotives that have so reliably hauled the juicy stalks of giant grass to the sugar mills. The tiny Quinaba mill near Bundaberg is about to phase out the last of the old locos still serving in the cane fields of Australia. Ever since Stevenson's rocket first chugged along its track, the combination of water and heat has held a certain fascination for the young and the not so young. Ron Atkinson has been looking down on the world from an engine's footplate for almost 30 years and earning calluses on his hands. Experienced drivers such as Ron Atkinson know that steam engines are more than clever arrangements of steel and brass. They're living creatures with a raging fire in their bellies and an insatiable appetite for coal and water. And each has a personality of its own. Two locos of identical design from the same builder can behave like children from different families. That's part of their magic. It explains why they demand special care and attention and why they capture the hearts of those lucky enough to gain their friendship. Today, Australia is the second largest exporter of raw sugar and leads the world in the mechanical harvesting of cane. The flashing blades of the last professional hand cutters disappeared just over a year ago. This year, they'll be followed by the tireless steamers who pulled their harvest along more than 3,000 kilometres of light railway line to the nation's 33 mills. Ron Atkinson talked about his long career on the Northern Tramways with Weekend magazine reporter Peter Greer.
What made you take it up? Oh, when I was a little child going to school, I used to watch him going past the back of our place. I used to think to myself, you know, when I get old enough, I'll be able to get on those things, and which I did do.
How will you remember them then, with affection or as hard, hot work?
Oh, well, I mean, I wouldn't say actually affection, but still in all, I enjoyed every bit of the time I spent on them.
When I first came, there was only very small engines, very small ones. You could only pull about 20 trucks at a time. Then you were scratching to get up some of the hills with them, but they've got a lot bigger engines now, and things have changed a lot since then.
Birth of the Queensland sugar industry more than a century ago, farmers processed small amounts of cane on their own properties with primitive machinery. Once bigger mills were built, transport became a major problem in the northern wetlands. Light railways were the solution, with horses doing the hard work. An enterprising gentleman named John Spiller is credited with being the first to use a steam locomotive to haul cane at his pioneer estate near Mackay. That was exactly a century ago. His engine was built locally at the former Victoria foundry. Most of the steamers used later came from England, although there were some from Scotland, France, Belgium, Germany, and the United States. At one time, 250 engines were working in the cane fields. After World War II, Australian builders took over, but within a few years, the days of the steam locos were numbered. The last of them appeared in 1953.
Well, I'd be sorry to see it go, really, because, they've been a jolly good old workhorse in their day, and there's no doubt about that, and a marvellous machine. And I wouldn't mind putting another 5 or 10 years even on them if they'd have been staying here. But still, I suppose, a diesel is a lot faster turnover. There's no wasted time like the steam engine.
Cronaba Mill is part of the Milliquin Sugar Company, which is in turn a wholly owned subsidiary of Bundaberg Sugar. It's the smallest of the company's four mills in the district, with a compact tramway network only 30 kilometres long. And it's because the system is so small that these antiquated veterans have been able to keep the young diesel upstarts out of the old boys' club for so long. Firestorms, which paint the sky above the cane paddocks every season, are probably one spectacular feature of the tropical north that will never disappear. A clean burn not only removes dead leaves and trash, but also drives out the rats, bandicoots and snakes. The ash and soot is sometimes called Bundaberg snow, for it can carry for kilometres to the clotheslines of sugar towns. Cane deteriorates rapidly once it's burnt and must be delivered to the mill as soon as possible. Fast and reliable transport is essential. The success of the whole crushing operation depends on a constant supply of cane to the mill, and the growers rely upon the loco crews to replace loaded trucks with empties. It's a huge game of chess, with the drivers keeping one move ahead all the time. These days, the sugar mill tramways are models of efficiency. Time is measured in dollars and cents, and the unrelenting wheels of progress are leaving the romantic age of steam far behind. The new heavyweights have made themselves at home on the old gauge of 2 feet, or 60 centimetres, although the creaky bed of ballast often needs strengthening. Some rail systems are more than 160 kilometres long, with train schedules worked out by computer. And there's not much change out of $200,000 when you go shopping for an ultra-modern diesel. Despite the energy crisis, industry officials are confident they've backed a winner. This year, the other crews will switch to diesel power, but Ron Atkinson will return to track maintenance. Narrow gauge enthusiasts, however, are keen to adopt the old workhorses to save them from the scrapper's torch or the ignominious fate of being laid to rust in some neglected playground. The only villain here is your imagination, and the heroine's peril is purely the creation of a clever camera. Judge the train not by its size, but by its workmanship. The lure of such locomotives is being reflected by a boom in model steam trains. And throughout Australia, enthusiasts are toiling to recreate the steam monsters of yesteryear. From Queensland, Gary Neat opens the throttle on the world of model steam trains.
Lack of brakes would seem to be the major problem. Still, I guess we're all big kids at heart. Frankly, I feel a little bit like Gulliver at the moment. Still, for those folks who remember the steam trains, then this old monster will bring back a lot of good memories. Frankly, it's amazing just how much power they have. An appropriate message outside this house should be a sign reading, "Beware of Trains." The house is in Ferry Street, Maryborough, and is home for Peter Olds, his family, and trains. Quite obviously, what sets the house apart from its neighbours is a 200-metre-long miniature railway track. The neighbours have long grown accustomed to Peter steaming past their kitchen window. Peter Olds is one of Australia's leading model train enthusiasts. He's been building the steam locomotives most of his adult life. His father was a pioneer of the art in Australia. These days, Peter passes his knowledge onto his son.
That just about finishes the testing on compressed air, Robert.
The pride of Peter's collection is Jupiter. It represents 3,000 man-hours of painstaking work, and to him, it's priceless. The locomotive is a scaled-down version of a train that operated with the Central Pacific Railroad in the United States during the 1860s. In an era of increasing technology, the steam train, or rather the scale model, is enjoying a period of unrivaled popularity. Hundreds of men throughout Australia adjourn to their workshed or garage each night to perfect their locomotives. The men themselves come from all walks of life. Peter Olds is a partner in a marine engineering company.
I've always
always said, it's in the sight, the sound and the smell. As we burn coal, it's got that appeal to most people. And the sound of them, the little boys, they go ch-ch-ch from a very early age, I suppose. And even this day and age, when we don't have many steam engines about, it's surprising to find the number of children that imitate the noise of a steam locomotive.
You bristle at the suggestion that this is kid stuff, don't you?
Well, it's everybody's entitled to their point of view, but I personally have always had a fascination for this activity, and it's very, very educational. Some people paint pictures, they put fabulous prices on them. I've had people refer to my engines as Rembrandts, and they're as pretty as pictures, I think, any of them. We've got some beautiful engines here today, and I don't like it referred to as playing trains. We're model engineers first and foremost, and I guess that's about the strength of it.
Maryborough is a particularly civic-minded city, so it didn't take the city fathers long to recognise the growing popularity of the model steam trains. A special track was laid in Maryborough's Queen's Park, and a body form called the Model Engineers and Live Steamers Association of Queensland. Now the track is a top money earner for local charities. Because the track is circular, speeds are generally restricted to a safe 40 kilometres an hour. Although many of the models can go much faster on a straight track. This is a model of the famous Rocket, built by Stephenson in 1829. In its day, it was a real speedster. These days, the model attracts considerable attention whenever it performs. The original Lion was built in 1838 and served with the Liverpool and Manchester Railway. The model is 1/12 the original size, even down to the nuts and bolts. For a century and a half, boys from 7 to 70 have had a fascination with steam trains. For most, they've become a rarity, a steaming, hissing reminder of another age. But a growing band of men are now faithfully recreating steam locomotives. Some might well call them expensive toys. To others, their presence ensures the survival, if only in miniature, of an era.
The sight and sound of a steam train can arouse strong emotions among people of all ages and from all walks of life. Indeed, just about anything associated with the bygone days of steam trains has a peculiar magic for the enthusiasts who look back with almost overwhelming nostalgia. Trading on this nostalgia has become a profitable sideline for the State Rail Authority in New South Wales. The authority has a shop at Central Station in Sydney, specialising in the sale of what was once regarded as junk. Established 2 years ago as part of the authority's innovative entrepreneurial image, the railway shop has been a striking commercial and public relations success. Not everything on display is for sale. The shop is as much a museum as a retail outlet. Customers come from all over the world, and few leave without buying some relic of the railways, or one of the new products developed for what appears to be an expanding market. According to the manager, Mike Bork, most would like to buy a steam train, but have to settle for something smaller.
Mainly small portable items which people can perhaps put on their mantelpiece at home or display. A lot of the crockery and glassware from our refreshment rooms. Other people are going more for something that's definitely railway, such as a lamp, a guard's lamp or station master's lamp, something of that nature.
What do the lamps sell for?
Well, they vary. Some people like to buy them in an as-is condition, which they can do up themselves for, say, about $75. Other people like to go the full way and get one that's been restored for up to $150. We have the large lamp that went on the top of the old signals, the semaphore signals. They vary in price from about $125 upwards.
The railway water bottle that you're selling has the SRA insignia on it. Where are the old ones?
They've all gone, unfortunately. That's one of our sad stories. They were withdrawn from service many years ago, and they were replaced with a newer product. But over the years, we found the glass was more suitable, and so we have reverted back to the glass because it's the new image that has the SRA on it now. They sell for about $30. The glasses date back to, say, the early 50s when our refreshment rooms were in the heyday, and in those days, at all the country rooms, we served draft beer. They're becoming very scarce now, and obviously the more exotic or the attractive types, such as the small sherry glasses and port glasses, went very quickly, and also the soda glasses, because of their uniqueness, which we used to serve the milkshakes in. Everyone sort of can remember those from the early days, and hence they went quickly. We only have a few left now, and they're $15 each. The crockery, again, is another interesting point because of its uniqueness with the brandings on it. And then within those, there's the various colours, which in its time it all had a meaning. It could have been a particular contractor supplied it or meant for a particular application. And this is making the items very collectible. Unfortunately, as with everything else in the shop here, it is very fast running out, and we're getting to the stage where we cannot guarantee the supply for very much longer. The crockery dates from possibly the mid-40s when the railway refreshment rooms were in their heyday, and as the years have gone by, so there's been many different styles have come out for different applications, some of it for on the trains and others for our various refreshment rooms. Some come in who just simply want one of each item to fill their collection. Others come in who would like a particular canteen of cutlery or a complete setting of crockery for their main dining at home. And then we have other people still who have come in to outfit a complete restaurant with a railway theme.
1966.
These coffee cups are very unique. Obviously there wasn't many of them made because this is the only small group that we've ever had come through of them. But unfortunately, we haven't ever had the sources for them. Now we're holding on to these because we know that someday, from a dark corner somewhere, the sources must turn up, and these will be very much sought after by our collectors. The whole area of silverware is a collectible area within itself. There are those people who collect nothing but silverware, be it railway silverware or silverware in general. And again, because of the uniqueness of our organisation, we have a vast variety of silverware that was made for different occasions. In our larger refreshment rooms, we used to give a full silver service, and hence we have all the various items that probably many younger people today would never have even seen before. And then going one step further, although we've not had much of it for sale, has been the odd items off the special trains, such as the Governor's carriage or the Premier's car. The supply of these items, naturally enough, is getting very, very low. Many of the items that were not in common usage have gone a long time ago because of their simply short supply. But the more common ones we still have today are the sugar bowls, coffee and tea pots, and the small dessert trays. Other items such as the large fruit bowl, there are perhaps maybe half a dozen of those left, but I would doubt if there's any more of those available. In the old days, on the branch lines, we used to use this signal for people to stop the train. And it's interesting because it's the only time a green signal was used to stop the train. The idea was the chain was affixed to the waiting shed, and the people, when they saw the train coming, would wave this out in front of the train to give the man the idea to stop for them. Now this, of course, is very interesting because it's a thing of the past now, with all the branch lines closing down, or alternatively people being moved by buses instead of the trains. These old platform lights are very interesting because many people would like to use them in their gardens, But unfortunately, there's few of them left these days because of our policy to put them onto older stations, which we are restoring. Because of the demand for these items, we have now had to manufacture the single bracket arm, which is versatile and can go onto a wall or directly onto a post in a smaller garden.
Teaspoons, tea towels, and T-shirts are among the newer items being retailed. And there's also a nice profit to be made out of books. In recent years, there's been a publishing boom in this field, and Mike Bork regrets that there's just not enough space to carry all the current titles. While the majority of customers are content to settle for something they can carry home, there are enthusiasts who think big. For them, the old railway rolling stock has special appeal. Demand for the carriages outstrips supply.
With rolling stock, we have to dispose of it by tender to give everyone a fair chance of bidding for it. It is normally advertised in the daily press as a state rail tender, and it is up to the people then to come out and inspect the vehicles after we notify them of the types. They must make sure it is what they want, that they have the facilities to then detach it from its bogies and its running gear and move it by road. Or alternatively, we can take it to a large country centre, but it is still their responsibility then to provide lifting equipment and the labour to move it from the running gear.
What do they sell for?
It's hard to generalise, but you could be looking in the vicinity of perhaps $500 up to maybe $1,000, depending on the condition of them and the type of vehicle that it is. But you must always remember that you do have that heavy road haulage cost at the other end.
Steam engine 3601 was one of the most admired engines on the New South Wales system. This magnificent scale model of the engine is owned by Mr. Phil Belvin of St. Ives in Sydney. He runs it around his garden. However, the garden also contains railway memorabilia on a grand scale. Full-size engines either waiting to be restored or ready to steam.
This is a Baldwin locomotive built in 1889 in Philadelphia. It's 2 foot gauge and it was built for Fairymead Mill in Queensland. It was the first steam cane locomotive to run in southern Queensland, and it's the only remaining 2 foot gauge Baldwin of this type in the world. Well, we're going to restore it over a period. It'll probably be a 5 to 10 year period, I would imagine, doing it ourselves. We have the boiler, the wheels, all the essential parts, even the bell, in fact. So it won't be too difficult to get it together again, as it originally was.
Phil Belvin, a colour consultant and artist, has his garage and basement packed with parts of steam engines. A fully restored loco sits in the front garden.
I always wanted to have trains or be a part of the train scene, and I collected them and ran them and so on. And so it evolved. But in 1972, my eldest son decided he wanted a cane locomotive, so we all went in with him. My younger son became interested too. My wife's always been interested, so we brought down a cane locomotive from Meridian Mill. And it was quite an operation. We had to close the road and build a track across the road to get it into the garden. The purpose only being to store it there so we could restore it, because there were a lot of things to be done to it. We had to retube part of the boiler and so on. And it's ready to steam now as soon as we can find a suitable track to run it on. Another of my interests is locomotive builder's plates. These were plates that were attached to the locomotive for identification, giving the builder's number and so forth, and other information relevant to the engine. We have about 300 altogether from all over the world. Quite a lot of Australian ones, of course, but most of our plates are from famous locomotives and significant ones. This is a fairly rare plate from the Vulcan Foundry in Lancashire. This came from a New South Wales 17 class locomotive, and it's a fairly early date, 1886, and as I said, a fairly rare plate. This is our oldest plate. It's a railway foundry from Leeds and came from a Spanish locomotive dated 1858, and it's very rare for plates to survive as old as this one.
On a family farm in the Blue Mountains, Phil Belblin has more railway memorabilia. He recently sold a restored engine to a tourist complex and hopes that one day his biggest engine will also be making nostalgic trips.
Well, this is a Hudswell Clark engine built in 1950 in Leeds, England, and it worked for most of its life at CSR's mills up in Mossman, North Queensland. And CSR very kindly donated this engine to us in 1976, I think it was. We brought it down from the mill and we've been restoring it ever since. Fortunately, we had a group with us when we brought it here, an enthusiast group who worked with us on it, and we really needed them because the tender had to be completely rebuilt. The front end of the tender was replaced. The bogies were stripped right down, tender bogies, and new springs put in and all the parts reconditioned. Tremendous variety of other work on the back head in the cab where we pulled out fittings and replaced bolts and studs and various other bits and pieces. So it was a major undertaking really for a kind of bush operation like this. We wanted at least two carriages to go with this engine, and this was a fairly tall order because there have been very few narrow gauge carriages built in this country and certainly survived into this era. But we found that the Queensland Railways were running rail motor trailer cars, of which these are two. They were just the right size in the car body, not in the bogies, which were 3'6" for the Queensland gauge. We bought two, brought them down, imported four bogies from South Africa of the 2-foot gauge heavy-duty bogies, which were required to carry the weight of a carriage of this size, and they'll be ideal for the carriages when we install them.
It's fairly unusual, though, isn't it, to have preserving steam engines as a personal hobby?
I think it is in this country, perhaps, although the interest is growing, and I guess, yes, it is unusual, certainly. It's not the thing you expect to see in the average backyard or even on the average farm.
What attracts you to it?
Well, I've always been attracted to steam. It's the same feeling, I suppose, of relaxation and enjoyment, perhaps. It's deeper than that with a steam locomotive. There's something about it, I must say, that's very human in quality, more so than other engines and other things. It's got an irresistible quality about it. It's quite different to any other machine. After all, steam has a very special magic.
Now a film that's as much about people as it is about trains, and yet it's about a railway restoration project that boggles the mind. It is to do no less than restore a complete railway in the north of the state of New South Wales, the old Dorrigo branch. And this film from the high-rating ABC series, A Big Country, tells the story of the Dorrigo branch, known far and wide as the Ragtag Railway.
Thank you. Right to go, mate.
There's something that words will never capture about steam trains. It's as if for some locomotives have a special force, a magnetism that draws and holds. Maybe it's the size, the history, or maybe they are, as some say, the nearest thing to a living being that man has created. Temperamental, warm-blooded, breathing. Many years have passed since this grand old Duchess had a timetable or a destination. She's one of countless steam locomotives put out of work by what's called progress. The men who saved her dream of building a monument for all Australians of the time when steam was king. But they know that a locomotive that can't move can't live. What they needed was a line. Years of searching ended on the branch line which runs inland from Coffs Harbour, up the Great Dividing Range to the town of Dorigo. Many said they couldn't have picked a worse line, that it should never have been built in the first place. It had taken 700 men in a decade to lay the steepest, windiest, most expensive 60 kilometres of railway line in the state. It was equally the most costly line to keep open. For 50 years, the New South Wales government persevered with landslips and trees burying the line, and floods washing away bridges and embankments.
Well, here we go again. These blokes are right. Just you come in here, Dennis. Right. One, two, three.
Finally, in the mid-1970s, they closed it. But its beauty and colourful history, these men couldn't pass by. Their dream is to create one of the finest rail museums in the world. The line would be perfect if they could tame it.
Hey! Sit down on this end.
That's better.
Just take it out a bit more.
All right, Chuck.
They would say they're just ordinary men, but they share a special brand of determination and have skills to match.
What do you reckon, Greg? I
have to eye it up and find out where it's bent.
It's pretty bad, isn't it? It must have hit that with a force, I reckon.
In everyday life, many are railway workers. Some drive electric commuter trains or diesel locomotives and spend their holidays here. Others have given up their jobs altogether to sweat every day on the line.
Come along towards me. Yeah, there. Mark that spot.
It took years of negotiation till finally the railways agreed and leased them the whole railway. Signals, stations and sidings included. In those years, the line deteriorated fast.
Get a couple of guys around this. We'll just lift this over and put it in place.
18 months of slogging, and they're still not even halfway there.
Where's it, Mark? Which is the mark that's set there, is it?
And is it marked, bro?
Yeah. Move it up so this is in the middle of the front.
Look at that a bit.
Mr. Downing, can you put the bar underneath there, please?
John, what does this machine do?
Oh, this straightens the rail. Let's see where it's been bent by the tree.
Yeah, all right.
We're going to try and straighten this rail without, put it in, instead of putting a new piece in, because we haven't got that many pieces around.
How many places are there along the track where you're really going to have to do big repair work?
There's about 20 really big jobs to do. We've still got about three or four washways there, where we've got to put the track back in.
But generally, do you think you're pretty lucky with this line, or is it in...
I think if we got it from when we started negotiating for it, we wouldn't have half the work that we've got to do now. But I mean, there's been a lot of hard, no luck in it, I don't think, it's just a lot of work.
How long do you think it'll be before you get it all finished?
What, the whole lot from Glenway to Dorrigo? I'd say about 45 years.
But they're not allowing themselves 45 years. They don't have anything like that amount of time. Time was never a worry in the old days. When steam ran on the line, it used to take 5 hours for the 43-mile one-way trip. They used to say there was plenty of time to admire the scenery. It wasn't just the endless bends and the continuous climbing, or the driver's lunch breaks that made the trip so long. There were all the stops at little settlements along the way. Towns like Meegan, Cascade, Loanna and Yulong. Places that depended upon the line for trade and communication. For half a century, life centred on the comings and goings of steam. Dorrigo, at its furthest extremity, thrived. The remote plateau was in touch with its market. Timber was the mainstay, but at harvest time, whole trainloads of potatoes went out. The district stuck to its trains till long after road transports had forced other lines to close. Finally, the decision could be put off no longer. The doors were locked at Dorrigo Station. Talk of steam and passengers coming back, as people old and young painting and polishing it back to life. It's to be home base for the Duchess, and the rest of the massive collection which will take thousands back to the grand old days of steam. Perched on the edge of town, the station's to be at the heart of the place once more.
There was an old chap over in the pub one day, he was a bit of a wag, the old fella, but there was a commercial traveller from Sydney there, and he said to him, how was it, he said, that they come to put the railway station so far away from the town? Oh, he said, I'm buggered if I know, unless it was because they wanted to have it near the railway line.
Can you remember the day that the first train arrived in Dorrigo, Pat?
Yes, I remember the day the first train arrived here.
It must have been a big... It was
a big day, so. Yes. And it was in the Christmas holidays, 1923. And, as I say, they put a 18-gallon keg on people in the town, and the... mob got drunk, including the fireman and the driver. And a couple of local blokes drove the train down as far as Meegan and left it there for them until they sobered up to take it on.
The railway department wouldn't have been real happy if they found out about that.
They would not. They wouldn't like to know it, would they? It was a good service, though, to the area. They used to put a an excursion train from here to Coffs Harbour on New Year's Day. It got well patronised. And they usually had one from Glenroy here for the Dorrigo Show. So it was really good service, and it was fairly well patronised.
How much did the line cost to build, Pat?
It cost £1 an inch.
That's an awful lot of money. God, it's hard to believe.
It's hard to believe.
Well, how did it cost that much?
They reckon that was the right time. Yeah. You think of 700 men, there were 2 years on it.
Yeah.
700 men.
Yeah. I wish we had that many people now. We'd be up here already.
Yeah. All along the line, people are pitching in to bring the old days back. Horsepower is making up for any lack of manpower. Timber getters whose jobs once depended upon the line can replace in a morning a washed out embankment that men armed only with picks and shovels took months to shape. Bert and his mates were there when trains laden with logs and sawn timber trundled down the track each day. Ply for aircraft frames, gum for rifle butts and tent poles, great piles for bridges, and the last of the cedar. They still talk of how the trains dominated their lives and moulded their communities.
Around about 1922, we were living at Yulong, and I used to sit out before ever I went to school and just watch the blokes working, you know. And I can remember the first time the train emerged out of the scrub, like it was all bush those days, and there she come right through to Yulong with the, you know, they bringing up more rails and things like that.
I can remember when Dad bought our first piano. It was a pianola. Well, we've still got it. It came by rail to Yulong and was put on a bullock wagon and taken to Tim's Bar, which was 2 miles along
like
the road.
Like a sandwich?
And I can remember that as a little child, about 3 years old. But,
he used to be a school teacher in Lowenna, and he used to ring up for his grog down the Glenray pub. And sales to disguise, to fool the kids, he used to order a Rhode Island Red Rooster and a dozen chickens. And the Rhode Island Red Rooster was a bottle of scotch and the dozen chickens was a dozen bottles of beer.
And that'd come up on the train?
That'd come up on the train, yes.
Yes, there's lots of things did come up on the train. I can remember talking about somebody to drink, reminds me of something to eat with the Dave Owen, Waffle, we used to call him. He was half Chinese. Used to come drive the train, drove up to Lowenna one day, had his lunch, drove on to Yulong with the train, and then remembered he'd left his lunchbox behind and backed the train right back to Lowenna. It was only a couple of miles, but he did this. But the thing was about that line in those days that it was just part and parcel of the area, and these things happened, and they made a lot of our entertainment.
Brings back old memories.
No, doesn't it? Old memories, eh? The old days.
Yeah. The old steam day. Beautiful, in pretty good condition, eh?
Yeah, you know, yes, considering, really good condition.
Considering
in the children's eyes, the enginemen were heroes. The district had nicknames for them all. Along with What For the Fireman, there was Nat Gool and the Charger, and Plonko and Radish and Flatbed. The Ragtag Railway was everyone's name for the unruly, unpredictable train service they ran. Schedules were rarely stuck to, and the laws the engineman lived by could not be found in any railway's manual.
Well, the trouble was there was no control up here, see, we could work it to suit ourselves, couldn't
we? Yeah, that's right.
Mainline blokes like the inspectors and the supers, as long as we done our job, they didn't worry us much.
They knew what was going on.
They knew that we were doing our job properly, we were getting the work done, and they didn't care much how we done it, so we... That's what we used to do.
As long as everything was fair and above board.
What was it like to drive a steam loco and train on this line?
Lovely. Lovely. I knew every inch of it. Knew if the rabbit went in the wrong burrow. And I loved it. And the steam engine up here, but the diesel weren't near as good. I didn't like the diesels as well. You weren't bustled or anything like that. You didn't have control to worry about on the main line. You just worked as you wanted to.
Everybody was happy.
Yeah, and everybody was happy. Well, I was sorry that it ever closed down myself. When they get it going, I hope I'm well enough to come up with them and show them a few points about different parts of the line and everything as in our old days, in the old steam engines and everything. I'm sure I can still fire one and drive one too.
At first, the idea of a dedicated bunch of amateurs reopening 60 kilometres of abandoned railway, building a world-class steam museum, and chugging visitors up on their own trains must have sounded like a pipe dream. But in their own quiet, determined way, the steam buffs have proved they mean business. Today, the whole region shares their vision. Each weekend, bodies softened by years behind desks come up for exercise that men before them really did for fun. Hard manual labour that blistered even the toughest skin. Side to Yulong. From Megan through Cascade, there were 700 navvying to get the ragtag laid. And the gangers made the sweat flow, for they held the upper hand. But slowly we moved upward through that drenched and dripping land. Bend your backs and lift that rail, lads. Fill your spade to Maker's name. Drive that spike, man, don't just tap it. Admit you're flagging if you're game. And the mountains found an equal in the rough and tumble gangs whose grit and bone and sinews took the ragtag up the range. When they started, much of the line lay broken or buried under a jungle of lantana. One task at a time, it's cleared and the gaps bridged. Dorigo is coming closer. Life between long, strenuous days on the track is lived in a base camp at the foot of the line.
Okay.
It's a junction where past and present meet. These men stick stoically with the past.
Lining it up. Lining it up.
World War I vintage ambulance cars are their bedrooms. Their kitchen's the cookhouse that served the band who first gave the line its ragtag reputation. What is it about steam that you find so special?
Oh, well, I was a steam enthusiast in the 60s, and when steam finished in the early 70s, I just felt that there was something missing out of my life, like the steam was in my blood. So I joined Keith's Museum, and we've been trying to get this line open because it's such a scenic line, and it'd be just beautiful to see the steam locomotives running up the line again. And
steam affects you that much, you fellas?
It's in the blood, yeah. Once it's in the blood, it's there forever.
It's there to stay.
Sounds like an unpleasant condition. Yeah.
All the work and hardship up on the line goes on for this. A whole valley of locomotives and rolling stock. Search hard enough and there's probably one of almost everything that ever rolled on rails in Australia. From the very smallest of guards vans to the oldest of carriages and the biggest of locomotives. The 260-ton Garrett.
I'll be able to give you a hand with those in a minute.
Okay, then I'll get John while I'm down
here. Righto.
It's only 10 years since it all began. Since one ancient engine, destined for the breaker's yard, was saved. They were going to stop at that. Then they learnt of another and another. And it snowballed on from there. So far, they've paid out over $400,000. And still, they search for pieces of Australia's railway past and feel a compulsion to add them to the enormous collection that's to be put on show.
Stuff, isn't it?
Till everything's safely under cover at Dorrigo, it must be protected from further decay. The splattering of sump oil and paint has become an initiation to the club. But it's a price that all are happy to pay to revive the days when life huffed and puffed and rattled to a gentler, more romantic pace. It's taken some shrewd minds and quick thinking to save an engine like this. The Duchess is one of the few types of locomotive that can handle the steep grades of the Dorrigo line. When she finally sets off for that town again, it will be as if nothing has changed.
This locomotive was built in 1902 by Bayer Peacock and Company in England, and was purchased by the then New South Wales Government Railways. It's a freight locomotive, hauled freight trains most of its life, and coal trains in the Newcastle area predominantly.
I noticed that it's called 5069. What does that mean?
50 is the class of the locomotive, and it's the 69th locomotive built in that class. So there were over 200 very similar locomotives in the 50 class.
It's loud, isn't it?
It is, no doubt. It's got to be to warn the motorists.
What makes this locomotive special to you in the museum?
It's one of the very few 50-class locomotives that survived until the modern days, and it's been unmodified in its condition. This class of locomotive at home on the Dorrigo line, it was of a type that was common on the Dorrigo line for bush trains. The steam locomotive is the nucleus of the museum from my point of view, and indeed most of the members almost idolise a steam locomotive. A lot of people have tried to define what the attraction is, but no one's successfully come up with a formula yet. So it's not really, a lot of people say, oh, they're big kids, they haven't grown up yet. But I don't know, we've got a hell of a lot of big kids if that's the case.
They'll be warming up the boiler. They'll be oiling up the gears. They'll be polishing and painting before the waves and tears. And she'll be cheered through every station and welcomed back once more by the youngsters and the old men who took the ragtag through before. Hear the sound of steam and pistons. Hear the scream of whistles blow. Hear the children and their parents roar as she heads for Dorrigo.
Hope you enjoyed this Thorn EMI video presentation. For more exciting attractions, write in for our catalogue.